Mine began with a six-week internship for Senator David Pryor from Arkansas, and that led to 8 years on Capitol Hill and then to the rest of my time being sucked into the vortex that is Washington, D.C. It's pretty addictive. I was able to spend some time with some students today at lunch, and a couple of them have been in Washington and already talking about how they can get back. And I can attest to the power of the D.C. vortex. So I, after getting the six-week internship on Capitol Hill, I say it's right place, right time, because I was one of the few interns that actually had graduated, and the other interns were going back to their senior year. So a position opened up that summer, and Senator Pryor asked me to take it. And I said, absolutely. Now, I give you an idea. This is 1989, and Capitol Hill has a very high interest level, people wanting to work on Capitol Hill, which means that, you know, supply and demand, this is a business school. My first job, I got paid $18,000 a year, living in a very high-cost place like Washington, D.C. I remember doing the math. It took me 3 weeks of pay to pay rent for the month. And that gave me 1 week of pay to do everything else. It was very difficult. But had the opportunity to move up. My first job was actually on the Senate Governmental Affairs Committee. Now it's called Government Affairs and Homeland Security. That's post September 11, 2001. But back then it was just the Government Affairs Committee. And we had the very important task of oversight of the U.S. Postal Service, which was probably the most boring thing I've ever done in my career. But it helped me understand Washington, how it works, how bills get through the Senate, how bills get through the House, how you have a conference, how you work with investigators. I got to do things like investigate the Postal Service, who was spending a heck of a lot of money on sponsoring the Olympics in Barcelona. And the question is, well, why was the Postal Service sponsoring the Olympics? It's being held in Barcelona. Yeah. We didn't know the answer. We went and looked, and it turned out that you really didn't have a good answer. It's just that they were jealous of this company, just up the road from here. I'm not sure which direction the Memphis is, but FedEx was getting all this express mail delivery. They were really jealous, and they wanted to have more. So they thought, well, we'll just go sponsor things, and then we'll be able to compete. Our question was, well, how does this help any given man if you're spending all this money over to Barcelona? We did another fun investigation. We found out that they had bought some property in New York to build the general mail facility, and turned out they couldn't use it. Then they bought another piece of property, and I thought, well, that's kind of silly. Why would you use the ratepayers' money to do that? And it turned out the head of the real estate department inside the Postal Service had a relationship with somebody that was trying to get rid of an old Phelps Dodge refinery. It was practically a Superfund site. And that was another example of waste that the government had. So it was a great way to understand Washington. I then got the opportunity in 1990, end of 92, to move over to Senator Pryor's personal office and work on agriculture issues. Now, I grew up in Arkansas, but I didn't grow up on a farm. And what I quickly learned is that you need to meet somebody that understands the very technical nature of farm programs and what it means for agriculture. And I just so happened to have the good fortune to meet a gentleman by the name of Dr. Mark Keenum. You may know him as your president from Mississippi State University. I know him as Mark. And he and I worked together from probably 92 till the end of 96 when the senator I worked for retired. He, of course, stayed on, had a great career in Capitol Hill, had a great career in Washington, came back to a great career here at Mississippi State University. I know he bleeds maroon. I've seen that many times, and I even have a lot of Mississippi State stuff because of our relationship. After Senator Pryor retired, this was the end of 96, beginning of 97, I had the opportunity to lobby on behalf of the National Colleges, Land-Grant Colleges and Universities. And it was there that I had the opportunity to step off Capitol Hill and be one that's trying to influence what happens on Capitol Hill. Now, I say the word influence, and I say the word special interest, and I'm proud of it. And I know what you're all thinking. Wait a minute, those are dirty words. People always talk about those nasty special interests in Washington. I'm here to tell you, you all have an interest, and all of those interests are special, and you all have advocates on your behalf in all those special interests. So I don't see it as a dirty word. I see it as a constitutional right to petition the government. It's in the First Amendment, the Bill of Rights. I'm very proud to be a registered lobbyist. I wear it, the badge of honor, because I get the opportunity to represent institutions like Mississippi State, Arkansas, and others. We represent the deans of the College of Agriculture, the directors of the Cooperative Extension Service, and working on some ag research reauthorization legislation. Took us a year and a half. We got it through. We had a Rose Garden signing ceremony with President Clinton. Now, it wasn't because of our bill. It was because, like so many things in Washington, in order to get something through, you have to marry it up with lots of other legislation. So, I guess it was a week later, this is a typical Washington story, a week later, I was having breakfast with my old chief of staff. When Senator Pryor retired, he had moved back to Little Rock, Arkansas. In fact, I talked to him yesterday. He still works for Stevens Inc., which is a big investment banking firm in Little Rock, Arkansas. And he and I were having breakfast, and he said, well, what do you want to do next? And I said, I don't know. I'd like to work on the golf game, because this is really good. But I don't want to work on appropriations and all the things that I think it would be on a career path to stay with representative universities. I'd like to do something different. And that night, he went to a fundraiser with several other representatives of Arkansas businesses and companies, one of which was a telecom company, Alltel. And the woman that ran the Alltel office, Diane Smith, really made a passing comment. She said, gosh, I'm tired of doing these fundraisers. I'd like to have somebody do my hill work. Do you know anybody? We had breakfast. Now, there's not much in the relation between agriculture and telecom when it comes to the committees of jurisdiction and everything else in Washington. So he said, do they need to know telecom? She said, no, they just need to know their way around the Capitol Hill. So we met, hit it off. She hired me. I learned about telecom. Kind of in the rearview mirror, because they had just passed the 96 Telecom Act, and the debate there was all about local versus long distance. Anybody here remember a long distance bill? There's a few folks that aren't current students, I see. I mean, that was a big debate in the mid-90s, and it was a very ferocious debate. Now, when they were doing the 96 Telecom Act, Dr. Keenum and I were working on the 96 Farm Bill. So I didn't really know much about what was happening. But I went to Alltel and learned a lot about what the debate had been all about. Had the opportunity to represent Alltel for a number of years. And then the one that hired me ended up moving to Montana, and I got the opportunity to leave the Washington office. I did that for a little while. My CEO at Alltel, a guy by the name of Scott Fuller, it was his turn, and they sort of rotate through chairman positions for boards of directors for trade associations. So Scott Ford was chairman of the board for CTIA, the Wireless Association. And it was Scott's job to lead a search committee to hire the next president and CEO of CTIA. So he found somebody by the name of Steve Largent. So if any football fans out there, Steve Largent was a wide receiver. He was drafted in the Seattle Seahawks. Actually, he was drafted to Houston, but he got transferred to the Seattle Seahawks team when their franchise first began, which was 40 years ago. They're celebrating their 40th anniversary this year. And he was a successful wide receiver. He held 10 records in the NFL. He was inducted, first Seattle Seahawk to be inducted into the NFL Hall of Fame. He went on to become a member of Congress representing Tulsa, Oklahoma. He went back to Oklahoma to run for governor. He lost. I used to know this number. He can tell you. It's like 1,267, something like that, votes, or he would have been governor of Oklahoma. But he lost that race, and he was looking for something else to do at about the time that CTI was looking for a new president and CEO. So they ended up hiring Steve, and my boss, the CEO of Alltel, one of the member companies and chairman of the board, asked me to help get Steve ready to take over the association. And so I met with him. He would call every other day. He would say, well, let me describe CTA for you. This is about 100 employees, about a $60 million budget. The members are Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile, Sprint, Apple, Samsung, LG, Motorola, all the companies that make up the wireless industry. And so I helped him get ready for taking over this trade association. Make sure he knew what the issues were, make sure he knew where his members, his very important members, stand on each of those issues. And it was a great relationship we developed. And one day he surprised me and said, well, why don't you come over and be my head lobbyist? Set up my lobbying team. So I took him up on the offer, moved from Altel to the Trade Association, and had a wonderful opportunity to represent the wireless industry. One of the first acts we did was we were able to get Congress to pass legislation to free up radio spectrum for the wireless industry. Because the more bandwidth that you try to do over your mobile phones, video, and everything else takes more and more spectrum. In fact, of all of the radio spectrum that all the wireless companies use today or that's available, it is still less than one strand of fiber. So it's a very finite resource, and it's hard to get enough radio spectrum for all of us to be able to do what we want to do in a mobile environment. But we had this really neat idea. We knew that the Pentagon and the Department of Defense had this spectrum that they weren't really using very efficiently. They had some really old weapon systems on there. And we wanted the opportunity to use that spectrum to auction it off to commercial providers to make sure that the carriers continue to offer robust services for all of us. Problem is, in Washington, it's very hard to get DOD to do anything. And if they had to then go and lobby Congress for the money to build a new weapon system in a different part of the radio spectrum, that's a lot to ask. So we had a unique solution. We said, well, wait a minute. What if Congress passes legislation that says the proceeds from the auction, so Verizon, AT&T, Sprint, T-Mobile, they're going to go to an auction, and they're going to bid billions of dollars for the license to use that radio spectrum. What if we took the first however much you need out of that pot? And you don't have to go ask Congress. We'll just sort of make it in the legislation for you. And we'll make sure that you get to upgrade, modernize weapon systems, move them into a different part of the radio spectrum. It's a win-win. It was very reluctant. They finally came around, and we finally got it through. And that was one of the first big acts we did. Steve then asked me to be his executive vice president, help him manage this association. I did that for probably 8 years. And during that time, I was fortunate enough to get calls by headhunters, executive recruitment firms, for different opportunities. And every time I told them the same thing, I've got the best job in the world. I don't want to change. But I started to think that Mr. Largent's kind of got a bunch of grandkids. My guess is he's going to want to start to enjoy his retirement. And he's probably not going to stay here forever, so maybe I'd start returning some of these opportunities. So 2 years ago, I got a call from Russell Reynolds, and they said, we'd like for you to consider the National Venture Capital Association. And my answer was, the what? I had not done anything in finance, I had not done anything in banking, I had not done anything in startup world, I knew nothing about venture capital. And the more I learned, the more I understood the membership that's part of the NVCA, the more interested I became in the opportunity. So I was fortunate to have a number of candidates to get selected. Is anybody here when you had John Callahan come speak here? John Callahan with True Ventures, I see a few hands. So John was actually on the board and on the search committee that interviewed me and other candidates. And I remember meeting John, and maybe you had this experience when he was here, of somebody that was so passionate about what they did and how important they feel that the contribution they're making to helping these startups and entrepreneurs build successful companies, and what those companies do for all of us, not only in this country, but across the world. And that infectious enthusiasm that John and the others had drew me in, and I knew this is where I wanted to be. So I got lucky. I got hired. I guess the beginning of September was my 2-year anniversary. And what I found when I got there was a trade association in Washington, been around over 40 years, but it kind of grown a little stale, a little tired, and the board really wanted me to come, try to bring new life to it, take it to the next level. And the next level for us is the ability to impact policy on behalf of our members. And I started by a very simple thing. We'll talk about this in a minute on one of the slides, but I started by going around meeting with all my board members, former board members and others, and kind of on a listening and learning tour, trying to understand what it is they wanted to see different and what it is they wanted to see the same for a trade association. And what we sort of started forming our vision around was the idea that if we're going to impact public policy, we need to do it from a little bit different vantage point. If we go into a senator's office or a member of Congress and we say, we're the National Venture Capital Association, and we represent venture capital, there's not a lot of sympathy. Venture capitalists, by and large, are pretty successful people. By and large, venture capitalists have really big checkbooks to write really big checks to startup companies to help them grow. So in a world in Washington where capitalism can sometimes be thought of as a dirty word, or if you have resources, if you're considered successful, then why do you need Washington to do anything for you? You're likely not to have a very receptive audience. So what we identified is really, what's the most important thing? What's the most important ingredient? And the answer quickly came back, it's the entrepreneurs. It's this entrepreneurial ecosystem which is so important to our country, to the innovation economy, to build new companies, to replace old companies that are going to die out over the next several years. That's what's important that we have in the U.S. That's what people all over the world get off planes every single day, out in California generally, trying to figure out how they create Silicon Valley in their own country. It's why they're taking, they meaning other countries, are taking great strides in changing tax policy and changing licensing policy and changing intellectual property laws and changing the way they support their own ecosystems in their country. They're changing it rapidly. They're trying to lure what we have had an advantage over the rest of the world in every single day. And so we, as an association, on behalf of our members, have to make the case to policymakers about what's important to this ecosystem. Tax policy, to make sure that we have capital formation available to put at great risk. Most of the companies that my members invest in fail. But it takes that failure is okay mentality to get to the success. Ask almost any entrepreneur and they'll tell you all about the failures they had along the way. They'll tell you about all the VCs that they went and talked to, or funders, angel funders, whoever, that turned them down. It only takes one. And they finally got those first investments and the help they needed along the way. So that's what we get to do at the National Venture Capital Association. We get to talk about the entrepreneurial ecosystem. We get to go in and talk to policymakers about what's important to that ecosystem. And when you put a policy debate through that lens, we're going to be far more successful than if we went in and said, hey, we represent mostly a bunch of rich white guys from California. So that's the vision. That's what we're trying to do in DCA. So now let me talk a little bit about what's going on in the industry. We put out about 4 or 5 press releases every quarter talking about where the industry stands at any given moment. What is venture capital? I admit it, I've only been around this 2 years. There are folks in this audience that probably have done a lot more than what Mr. Kaplitz and me, but let me give you a little bit about what I've learned. Venture capital is really, it's that rocket fuel that helps entrepreneurs take off with a great idea. It's helped every one of the logos on the screen. These were all venture-backed companies. Imagine the ideas at the beginning that the entrepreneurs, Larry, Sergey, Elon, the people that started these companies had, and all the no's that they got, all the failures they had along the way. You can read about it, you can read about the history of these companies. I mean, this is just a small sample. But these are great examples of what it took after they got that rocket fuel, after they got those venture investments, after the venture capitalists and others that got on their board and helped them design a business that would take off. It creates whole new industries. Y'all recognize a Fitbit. I'm sure some of you have one. John Callahan, who was here, who we talked about earlier, was the first institutional money in Fitbit, probably 8 years ago. As you may know, a few months ago, Fitbit went public. As I checked my phone earlier today, its market cap's a little over $7 billion. His first money in Fitbit means that the fund, I don't know how many funds he has, but the fund that he invested in Fitbit owns 21 or 22% of north of $7 billion. Pretty good exit. Now, if he were here, what we would ask him is how many failures, how many investments, and how many other companies did he make that he saw all of that go away? That's how venture capital works. Very high risk, very high return opportunity. Let's unpack that a little bit. Fundraising. So John, I'm just going to use John as an example because I know he was here. John and his partners have to go out and raise money. They go to endowments, pension funds, sovereign wealth nations, family offices, fund of funds. There are a lot of sources. But imagine, you're going to these folks and you're trying to get them to write really big checks. That's a lot to ask, particularly if you're just starting out. I mean, how does a new venture capitalist raise their first fund? And the answer is it's really hard, and that's why most of them, like John in this example, have been a successful entrepreneur himself. He started his first company when he was in college, a mountain bike company. He then went on to start two other companies. So he knew what it takes. And I'm sure that in those first pitches he made to potential limited partners, to make investments in his fund, he draw on the experience he had as a successful entrepreneur. So you convince him to make the investment. You raise your fund, you have 100 million, whatever the number is. By the way, in the industry today, we're seeing a barbell effect. So the firms that raise the biggest funds, NEA, Andreessen Horowitz, Kleiner Perkins, they're continuing to raise really big funds. NEA closed a fund earlier, it's fund 15 or 16, I don't know what number. They're the biggest venture firm in the country, and it was just under, right at $3 billion. On the other hand, the barbell, we see a lot of micro VCs. We see a lot of people that are trying to get into the venture business by raising very small amounts, 6 million, 10 million, something fairly small in venture standards. It's still institutional money, but their philosophy and theory is that they're going to have a better opportunity to have successful returns, but they're only focusing on that amount of money. And it also, it's a lot less expensive to start a company today than it used to be. Used to, you have to go out and you had to find office space and you had to order servers and you had to pay somebody to come hook them up and you had to pay for the software. You had to do all this stuff. Now you just go to the cloud. You rent space, Amazon Cloud Services, you can be up and running in a couple of days. So, Venture capitalists go out, they raise the fund, then they have to invest it. They've got to have a deal flow, is the term of art. They've got to have a line of entrepreneurs coming through the door, euphemistically, to present their ideas. They have to see a lot of pitches. Now, they see 100 pitches, and they only invested in two. But it's that constant deal flow that they have to be looking at. But they still have to make an investment. They have to put that capital to work. Now, the money they raise, the term sheets typically have a 10-year period. And that fund is typically designed to go for 10 years. Many of them have automatic extensions for another 5 years. That's a long time. And if you are raising money from somebody and they know that they can't, their limited partner can't call up and say, you know what, things have changed, I've changed my mind, let me have that money back. It doesn't work that way. It does in other private equity, hedge funds, and others, but not to venture capital. That money's locked up for a long time. Very illiquid. You've got to put it to work. You start looking at companies. You start investing in those companies. And you start sitting on those boards. And you try to help those companies become successful. And by the way, that last point, talking about follow-on rounds, you have to think about, when you make that first investment, you have to imagine, how much more is this entrepreneur going to need if this continues to take off? And you have to reserve what they call dry powder out of that fund in order to make sure that that company has what it needs to make it to the next level. And you want to make sure you have dry powder, particularly with the logos that we saw earlier, so that you don't start to lose your position in that company and the percentage ownership. I'd be curious, I should ask John Callahan a question on Fitbit. How many rounds did he participate in to make sure he maintained 22% of what's now worth a $7 billion company? So you make the investments. You work with the company. You go on their board. You help advise them. You help them hire the right people as they're ramping up. You introduce them to the right service providers, accountants, lawyers, banks, investment, everything. I mean, you've done this before. You're sitting on 7 or 8 portfolio company boards at any one time. One of the first things I learned as head of the MDCA is that if I want to talk to one of my board members, I need to plan it 2 weeks out. Because it's like their calendar is completely jam-packed for a 2-week solid period. They are constantly on calls. They're constantly at board meetings. They're constantly at visits. They may be out constantly fundraising that next fund. So they'll raise one fund, and assuming they have a good track record and success, maybe even before that fund gets totally invested, they might go out 3 years later and start fund two. And it's a cycle that keeps moving along. Exit. Everybody know what an exit is? Exit is an IPO or merger and acquisition. It's that successful, we sold the company, or we went public. We got out of this little startup ecosystem that we've been in, we've made it. That's what they're looking for, venture capital and the entrepreneurs. The interests are perfectly aligned. The more successful the entrepreneur is, the more successful the venture capitalist is, the more successful the venture capitalist is in helping them get there, the more successful the entrepreneur is. They're looking for those exits. They get those returns. They get that $7 billion market cap by going public if you're fit there. The way you do money, you gotta give it back. You give it back to those investors that took the chance, the endowments, the pension funds, the family offices, the sovereign wealth nations, all the people that helped you raise that fund. You first give them back what they gave you. Then you give them back most of the profits. Now, we talked about it, the different groups that you would go raise money from. Just for a second, let's put on our endowment hat. We're the Mississippi State University Endowment. We have, make up a number, $100 million. you all know, this is a business school. We need to have a diversified portfolio to make sure that that endowment is continuing to earn money. You have some in stocks, you have some in bonds, you have some in different assets. What you may think about as a manager of that endowment is this little sliver over here called alternative assets. And within that little sliver, there may be lots of opportunities. Maybe you can put it in a hedge fund, maybe you can put it in a big private equity buyout fund. Maybe, just a little bitty tiny slice of that, you put in venture funds. That's sort of where we sit in the sort of spectrum of investment opportunities for big money managers. So they take a little bit, they invest it in John's fund. John's fund has a Fitbit home run. They get good returns. Everybody's happy. And hopefully what happens is, that was a good experience with John. John's around, he's ready to raise fund 7 or whatever number he's on. I would guess some of the limited partners that benefited from his success with Fitbit believe that he knows what he's doing and picking entrepreneurs and helping them grow successful companies. And so they're probably more likely to invest in the next fund John has. So that's sort of how venture capital works. Let's look at what's happening today. Our data provider is a partnership with PwC based on Thomson Reuters data, and that's called the Money Tree Report in terms of what's been invested. And then Thomson Reuters also gives us the data in terms of exits and other things. So let's take a look. I put this up here because if you know anything about the venture capital industry, you know about this road. As an organization, we have 400 member firms. Probably 60 or 70% are in the San Francisco Bay Area, Silicon Valley, and the majority of those have an office address at Sand Hill Road. So if you ever hear the term Sand Hill Road, that's where it comes from. It's an actual street, runs between Menlo Park and Palo Alto. Stanford University is over here, and there are all these little office parks, and that's where the venture capital firms are. So, the investment value, looking at the Money Tree Report, and the last bar, it's a strike like that to note that that's just the first half of this year. We haven't done the third quarter yet, but this shows you kind of what's happened over the last several years as far as money, venture capital money being invested in portfolio companies. So it's on the rise. If we continue the second half of this year, we're certainly going to eclipse last year. Last year certainly eclipsed 2013. So in terms of money being invested in venture capital backed portfolio companies, it's on the rise. Now, there's not an asterisk up here, but let me give it to you. The asterisk is there's a bit of a new phenomenon over the last year, and that is that non-venture capital money is coming into our ecosystem. And most believe that the phenomenon is because there are a lot of companies that are choosing to stay private longer instead of going public. Who's heard of Uber? Do they have Uber here in Starkville? No? I'm sure it's coming. And it is a great, great company. Uber is now worth how many billions of dollars at valuation? It's all private money. Now, Uber is a great example of a company that should have been public by now, or certainly in the past would have been public by now. And so because it's still private and they have the opportunity to get money, well, the venture capital, they can't do all of that. So what we're seeing now is like Fidelity and others that are not venture firms or venture money, but they're coming down in and they're taking direct investments in some of these, what I would call pre-IPO stage companies. And so you see a little distortion in what some of the numbers are. We get asked about this all the time. That's why I want to make sure to describe that. Certainly from when you break it up by quarters, this is what it looks. The blue line is the number of deals, gives you an idea. And then the total dollars. And the reason you would have the blue line go way up is you would have companies that don't need that much money. We got a lot of companies with a little bit of money, or sometimes you get the couple of companies that raise a lot of money, like an Uber round. Looking at the industry, and I hate this graph, and I talked to our research person about we've got to change this. And we need to work with our data provider to try to break up software. Everything's considered software these days. Everything has software in it. And too many times they throw it into just the software bucket. And I don't think that tells the right story. But you can see a lot of the other categories that are in there. Telecom way down. Media and entertainment probably second. Biotech has been big. If you follow IPO market, biotech companies have been the majority of the IPOs after the last year or so. My guess is it's a lot of them were in the queue waiting, ready to go. They're looking for the right environment. They tend to watch and see if other biotech companies have successful IPO launches. And when they do, it's kind of a herd mentality. And so that's what we see here. Stage of investment. Tiny little graph over there at the beginning. Startup and seed. Now, I can explain that a couple different ways. They already said it takes a lot less money to start a company. In my lunch with some students, I got asked about crowdfunding. That can explain that. If there wasn't a venture investment in the company, but it was all an angel's list, syndicated angel groups, crowdfunding, whatever it might be, bootstrap, friends and family, however those companies are getting started now, what this tells us is that venture and the more institutional money is coming in a little bit later. I think it's healthy. I think having lots of opportunities for companies to get started is a great thing for the ecosystem. So I get asked, is that logical? No, I think it's healthy. Look at regions. Not a surprise Silicon Valley would be the highest. That is sort of the epicenter. What our data is starting to show, though, is that year over year, we're starting to see more MSAs, metropolitan statistical areas, get an investment. And particularly in a state like Mississippi or my home state next to Arkansas, this is a good trend. We hope to see that continue. What we hope is that the ecosystem really starts to spread out into different parts of the country. It used to be that venture capitalists would say they're not going to invest in a company that's not an hour's drive from their office. And I think that's why we saw a lot of the concentration in the Bay Area. That's loosening up now. And in fact, the prices are so high, real estate for talent, for engineers, for whoever, to build companies, that you're really starting to see people say, why would I want to start a company there? All the money that I'm raising to start that company, I'm having to spend on things that I shouldn't have to spend on. So you're starting to see the impact of, frankly, San Francisco Bay Area pricing itself out of the market. It'll take a while. Corporate. Last year, it was over 10% of the money came from corporate venture funds. What's a corporate venture? I have two board members out of 29. One is from General Electric, one's from IBM. They run the venture programs at their corporations. I think it's been quite a phenomenon over the past decade or two. I mean, a lot of corporations got into it right before the dot-com, the 2000 bubble burst, and then they ran away, and now they're coming back. Corporations these days aren't like the corporations of decades ago. I spent 15 years in telecom, as I told you. I mean, Bell Labs, that was all R&D from Ma Bell. Companies spent a lot of money in research and development that they don't spend now. So this is a great answer for them. We can reserve some money on our balance sheet. We can raise a dedicated fund. But we should be part of this entrepreneurial ecosystem so we as a company know what's happening in innovation in the area that we are in business for. So a lot of corporations are starting to create venture lines. And so we're starting to track that, what that looks like, and their participation in the industry. Another look at it. see it's on track. If it absolutely doubled here, it would be more this year than last. Don Callahan, you may recognize him, he's sort of second from the left on the front row. He's the one that I've been talking about this morning. He's a true venture. He's also the chairman of my board. That was the day they had the listing. Exits. So, the blue bar meaning the IPOs. The IPO market arguably got bollocks up. And a lot of different theories on why companies weren't doing IPOs. One of the things that I'm, and it was before I got here, but an NDCA did that I'm very proud of, is that we worked with Congress to pass something called the Jobs Act back in 2012. And one of the things the Jobs Act did was it created an opportunity for companies that were thinking about going public to do so in a confidential way. Up until then, if you were thinking about going public, you had to pretty much disclose everything. And then if you went out on a roadshow and it turned out that, well, this isn't the right time for us to go public, well, here you have just sort of spilled all your secrets out there into the public domain. It was a real disincentive unless you absolutely knew it was right for you to go public. So part of the Jobs Act had this confidential filing that you could go to the Securities and Exchange Commission and say, I'm just trying to test the waters here. And it's a great example of what I would say is great public policy. And as a result of that, we saw the 81, the 117 last year. Now the question is, well, yeah, but we're not on a very good track this year. I don't know the answer now. There's a lot of theories. Maybe it's what's happening in China. Maybe it's what's happening in our own markets over the last several weeks. But maybe that we just had a lot of pent-up demand that was just all ready at the same time to go when they could, and it hasn't leveled out yet. This is something that we will continue to watch the rest of this year. And I hesitate on the green even to talk about it, because one of the gaps in our data is that most mergers and acquisitions don't disclose terms, and we can't cap it. So this needs to have a big asterisk that basically says, of disclosed mergers and acquisitions, here's what some of the numbers are. That's looking at it by quarter. IT, lots of M&A, life sciences, biotech in particular, most of the IPOs. We talked about how you raise funds. So this is sort of a show of health of the industry, whether or not there are limited partners willing to reinvest. Number of funds, how much money they've raised, you can see clearly on the upswing for venture capital firms. Looking at those commitments by year, on track to have a better year now than last year. And by the way, I'll be happy to share with the established computer. I'll send it to whoever you like to have it. I'm going through these kind of things. New and follow-on funds. I talked about the entrepreneurial ecosystem. What does that look like? You are part of the entrepreneurial ecosystem. You're part of the university. Universities are part of it in lots of different ways. You're part of it because you may have endowments that make investments in venture firms. You're part of it because you may do research, and some of that research, they have a tech transfer office that tries to commercialize that research and start companies from it. Some of the most successful companies that we see are those that really came out of a university environment. And so part of what we do in telling our story and talking to policymakers is making sure they understand this ecosystem environment and all of the different players. Everyone's important to the health of this entrepreneurial ecosystem. There are founders, there are incubators, accelerators, research outfit, trade associations, service providers, VCs, name. I mean, that's the way we think about it when we use the term entrepreneurial ecosystem. Anybody watch the Silicon Valley show? If you haven't, it's pretty funny. It's surprising for those that have seen it, you see some of the characters. This is on, what's it on? HBO? It's a pretty funny show. Not kid friendly, I have young kids, so they can't watch it. But it is amazing. I watch it every week when it's in season. And it's amazing to see the characters they use. And in the 2 years I've been in the industry, I can identify the people they're trying to kind of parody. In several of the episodes where they've gone to meet with the venture capitalists and so forth, you can tell who they were modeled after. And many in the industry were helping them. And I love that show. Silicon Valley is still reigning supreme over the entrepreneurial ecosystem. But as I mentioned earlier, both with the data on MSAs, both with the anecdotal evidence, one company in particular I was talking to, they said, we need so many engineers, we can't afford to compete with them in the Bay Area. My wife's from Alabama, I'm going to start a company in Huntsville. Turns out there's a lot of engineers around the NASA operations in Huntsville, Alabama, and he's having wild success in getting the type of talent he needs to grow his company. I'd love to say yes, it's going to happen. I hope it happens. I hope what we see is a distribution of this entrepreneurial ecosystem away from California, more distributed across the country. And, you know, when I go through and see what you're building here in Mississippi State, when I was in Little Rock yesterday and seeing the Arkansas Innovation Hub with 3D printers and cutters and makerspace and all of that, I mean, I think we're all starting to understand what it takes to create these entrepreneurial ecosystems in a more localized, regional way. And that's something that we at NBCA are committed to try to help happen. We want to see our members get on planes, come out here, see what's going on. We want to see great entrepreneurs get the seed capital to get started, have the opportunity to raise their Series A and their Series B and their Series C where they want to be, and make successful companies across the country. That's what's important for the economic health of our country going forward. It can't be all in one place. Even as great as Silicon Valley is, we have to get that more distributed across the country. And that's something we spend a lot of time thinking about. Others keep trying to beat Silicon Valley. You know where Silicon Slope is? That's in Salt Lake City, Utah. Silicon Beach, Silicon Alley, New York. Silicon Curve, what would you call it? Anybody got a catchy name? Silicon Delta? Well, we took thought, folks, is focus on your strengths. I know that here, is it at the engineering school, at the Center for Drones, that the FAA has identified Mississippi State? Dr. Keenan and I have talked about this, but I think that it's a great example of where you have particular expertise. Where drones could really take off. Yeah, maybe in making movies, but maybe in helping farmers and agriculture get a lot more efficient about what happens in the crops. Being able to very cost effectively monitor what's going on and what they need. I mean, it would be great to see a lot of companies spring up around what you all have with other parts of the country. But I kind of talked about this. I think our role is to make sure that we have a healthy entrepreneurial ecosystem, whatever we can do to make it even more healthy. We think it's our job to convene parts of that ecosystem and to certainly work on the policies that matter. We advocate for public policy. Our biggest priorities right now have to do with capital formation and the impact of taxes. There's a lot of talk about tax reform. It's not going to happen until after the presidential election. We saw one presidential candidate come out yesterday with the tax idea. We've seen several being thrown around in the debate. The conversation we have with policymakers is, don't forget, yes, it's important that you bring the corporate rate down to 35%, highest in the world. But if, in order to bring the 35% corporate rate down to something reasonable, if you have to do the math by raising the capital gains rate, which is what is important for people to park the dollars for long periods of time, like in the venture ecosystem, then you're robbing Peter to pay Paul. You're focused on a snapshot of today's companies, trying to make them more competitive at the expense of the pipeline of new U.S. companies that are going to come into our economy over the next decade. And we think that's part of our job, is to make sure they understand the challenges and risks of making certain policy decisions with regard to taxes. Other issues, we get involved in cybersecurity, we get involved in patent litigation reform, as we've been working on very hard this year. There's legislation to stop the so-called patent trolls. And who could possibly be against stopping patent trolls? The answer is nobody. But when you actually look at legislation that has been introduced to stop patent trolls, it turns out it has a significant impact on honest companies that have intellectual property. That might be the only valuable thing that startup has to make it. And they need to be able to protect that. And some of the legislation that's been on the table in Congress would have significant consequences. Two in particular. One, automatic fee shifting. What does that mean? It means that if I'm in litigation and I lose, I have to pay the lawyer fees for the winning party. Sounds great. Sounds like court reform. Sounds like what I'll be for. But if you're a small portfolio company, and it turns out that the larger companies are really your problem, you don't have a patent troll problem, you have a big company problem. And the big tech companies want to step on your intellectual property, well, then you just tip the balance in favor of them. They can take a lot of people to court, or be sued by a lot of people. They can step on a lot of intellectual property, because they know that the price of you protecting your intellectual property just went way, way up. The second and most important provision that we've been fighting against is something called the joiner issue. Now, the reason the joiner issue is in the legislation is because the patent trolls tend to be funded by investors, and they tend to be in shell corporations trying to protect themselves from the activity of patent trolls. So the legislation is trying to go after them. But in doing so, they pierce the corporate veil. And suddenly, a VC is used to taking a lot of risk. They're used to losing all of the money they've invested in a company. What they're not used to doing is losing all that money and then suddenly being on the hook for a bunch of legal fees from some last-ditch effort to save a company or to get some asset value out of it. We spent a lot of time on that. Clean tech issues, life science issues, the Food and Drug Administration, responsible for approving drugs and medical devices, the CMA reimbursement mechanism of healthcare. I know very little about it. But it is, you know, it's one thing to come up with these great inventions that help reduce costs in our healthcare system. But typically, when you first come up with it, it's not the least expensive thing in the room. And we have to make sure that policymakers understand if we want to incentivize innovation that can improve our health, that in the beginning, it may be a little more expensive. It can come down over time. Now, I say that knowing that many of you saw in the news recently where it wasn't a venture capital firm. It was a private equity guy who bought a drug and jacked up the price 5,000%. And everybody came down hard. I hope they do come down hard. That's not what I've seen in the members that I work with that invest in life sciences. He's not a venture capitalist. He's a hedge fund manager, something like that. But it is, you know, that's not what we see. But too often the debate in Washington is about what's the cheapest option. And sometimes the cheapest option is not going to incentivize new innovation in them. That's what I wanted to share with you. I hope I left time for some questions and get an idea of what's on your mind and see what I can answer.
Good question.
Yeah.
My name is John Collins.
say tax policy, because if something changed in the form of tax policy that made an endowment, a family office, all the places where they go to raise money into their funds, if something changed so that didn't look attractive anymore, that could really, this is a small industry. If you look, the number last year was about $48 billion, round up to 50. $50 billion in our economy, and the other options of which people would have to place investment, it's tiny. And so making the wrong policy decision on taxes or how it's treated or something can have a significant impact. But there are lots of policy issues that are important. Immigration, patent reform. And I've got folks that tell me that if those bills pass that we were able to slow down this summer, they'd quit investing. If there wasn't this belief that you could protect the intellectual property of your company, why would you invest in it? If you're going to spend this money and somebody can come steal it, you don't have a way to defend yourself. So there are lots. I'm not sure I can pick one. If you made me, I would say tax, but there are a lot that are hugely important. Good question. There's one up here.
I'm Samuel Tate. I'm a senior management major. I was going to ask, what gave you the confidence that you were making all the right turns along your career path?
Wow, good question. Gave you the confidence? Are you born with confidence or do you earn it? That's a good question. That's a philosophical question. I feel like I had the opportunity at a very young age, right out of college, work in the United States Senate, to staff my boss, to sit on the floor of the Senate, to be engaged in debates. I mean, one time I was in a back room, and I already talked about the smoke-filled back rooms in Washington. It didn't have smoke in it. They don't really smoke as much as they used to. But we were in this little room, and sitting around the table was Majority Leader Tom Daschle, Senator Ted Kennedy, Senator Hal Heflin, Senator John Glenn. I mean, if these names, I don't know if they mean anything to you, but I mean, these were giants in the Senate. And we were debating the 1993 Budget Reconciliation Act. And Senator Pryor had a priority on behalf of agriculture and farmers that he represented. And it had to do with the ag products that you could use on crops. And in the 1950s, there was legislation that was enacted that had, it was called the Delaney Clause. And it said if anything is a known carcinogen, you can't use it. Well, in 1950, we didn't have the technology to look in like parts per million. And now we're looking at parts per billion. And you start to understand that, well, that's not zero, but it is so negligible, there is no harm. And yet it's keeping our ag producers from things that it might help increase yield, increase in making us have an affordable and abundant food and fiber supply. I always say fiber because cotton. And we were in this sort of pitched debate, and I had the opportunity to stand there with my boss and sit at the table, and he turned around to me and said, I got to go to a press conference. You can speak for me. And Senator Daschle said, okay. And so when it came to this issue, I had to get up in front of these giants of the Senate and basically make the senator's arguments. And one of the greatest experiences of my career was I laid it out, and I was sort of against Ted Kennedy. He was on the other side of the argument. And so we were having this debate, and Hal Heflin, who was a senator from Alabama, said, I'm with Bobby. That's the highlight of my Senate career. So having experiences like that start to gain confidence. I think it's about repetition. It's about getting up and speaking in front of people. The more you do it, the more comfortable you become. I think that gives you confidence to make the right decision. Good question. Yes.
I'm Betty Thomas. I'm an agribusiness major, and you have blogging for so many diverse industries. How did you educate yourself on each industry with every career change?
Well, first of all, let me say that's what I love about Washington is that you get to learn so much about every different industry. What I've used is, like I started here today talking about, when I got into agriculture, I wanted to identify who knew more about it than I did, and I wanted to learn what I could from them. And for me, that was Mark King, your president. And you know, being able to have a good friend, somebody that you trust, who you rely on, you know, knows the answer, and get what you can from them. Obviously, reading and meeting with people in the industry. I mean, in Washington, I would say a lot less reading and a lot more interaction, taking meetings with people who are in the industry, learning from farmers, learning from constituents, learning from lobbyists. And that's the important role that lobbyists play. They help educate policymakers and their staff so that they can make the best decisions from an informed position. Yes?
So I'm Preston Simpson, senior in electrical engineering. And my question was, so does the NVCA also work in regards to visa reform, especially in regards to like H-1B visa?
And immigration issues, absolutely. So H-1B visas are mostly for the big tech companies. Meaning, they figured out whenever H-1Bs open up, they know how to gobble them up. And for startups and even venture capitalists, they're just not equipped to sort of get the H-1B visas. So that's why NVCA played an important role in the comprehensive immigration reform debate that happened. A bill passed the Senate, you may recall, didn't make it through the House. But in that bill, there were provisions that we worked on that talked about as a startup visa provision. It talked about the fact that if you're an entrepreneur and you're from another country and you've actually gotten one of the venture capitalists to make an investment in you and your idea, why wouldn't we want you to stay in this country and build your company here? And it was a no-brainer. And then, you know, I often talk about immigration and everybody says, ooh, this is controversy. Illegal immigration is controversial. Legal immigration, particularly for those that are trying to build companies in our country, is not controversial. And everyone agrees with it. It gets a little harder when you get into making sure that we have enough engineers, we have enough workers to help these companies grow quickly. That gets a little more controversial. But we are absolutely for the right immigration policies to make sure that inform more immigrants and the help they need to start to grow their companies.